Everybody knows Planet of the Apes.
I can remember going to a Dusk to Dawn drive-in marathon as a kid. I was a big fan, especially the original.
I was a massive fan of the original Planet of the Apes. I saw it when I was a teenager, 12, 13, and was blown away by it. I'd never seen anything like it.
Take your stinking paws off me, you damn dirty ape!
The original movie has some very iconic images.
The apes on horseback leading battle charges with nets catching human beings.
There's just something about the ape riding a horse. It's like something out of Roman Colosseum or something. And then, of course, the final image of the Statue of Liberty.
I was mesmerized by it and totally believed that they were apes that could walk bipedally and communicate using human language. There was just no question that it was for real.
Where the other movies jump into the story and the apes are full-blown talking humanoids with their own developed culture and world, our movie has none of that. It's really showing how the seeds of those later worlds were planted.
Meet Chimp 9. We gave him a gene therapy that allows the brain to create its own cells in order to repair itself.
We call it the cure to Alzheimer's.
If you think of all the great stories in narrative history, there's always the opportunity to go back. And this one in particular, I think what is great is the beauty of the original story in so many ways is, what is this world? How did this world come about? And Charlton Heston on the beach, dragging his hands through the sand, saying, you did it, you really went and did it. That, to me, is the springboard for this story. What we're doing is we're setting up the idea that this is a story about the end of our civilization and the beginning of a new one.
I had collected a variety of material for different ideas for scripts. Everything from genetic research. I'd been following that several chimps had attacked their owners. You know, there'd been a lot of that in the news in the last number of years. And then I'd done some research on that and found that there's a huge number of people in the United States that are raising all kinds of primates. But I just kept staring at it, thinking there's got to be a good idea for a story here somewhere. And the truth of the idea just popped. Oh my God, I think this is Planet of the Apes.
It's actually more in keeping with the way we as a species deal with animals and how we've separated ourselves from animals. We see ourselves as humans. And animals are animals, donkeys and horses, they're animals. We cast them all in one light. And there's therefore always that thought that we are better than them. Apes and chimpanzees in particular, we've tried to domesticize them, we've used them, we've exploited them. And this story is about the turning point, the tipping point for that.
Thematically, we were very interested in man's hubris. That's one of the greater, if not the great theme in this script.
I'll tell you exactly what we're dealing with here. We're dealing with a drug that is worth more than everything else we are developing combined.
Where the characters cross the line in terms of hubris is this, well, okay, we can cure Alzheimer's, but wait a minute, are you saying we can also increase intelligence? And that's when you start to play God, and that's what gets us into trouble scientifically in the movie.
We will proceed without you.
Ready and action.
It was very important to try and get the mythology as close as possible and to respect the original, which we had great respect for anyway, but all the films.
Once the idea came together that we were going to reinvent Planet of the Apes, we knew what the general idea was. But then we started researching and watching all the old movies. And there's a reference in one of the films that the first ape to lead was named Caesar. And the first word spoken was no. And we built our movie around that moment, that Caesar would at some point rise up, look a human in the eye, and say the word no. And for us, we thought if we could build to that correctly and deliver it, then it would be like the moment where everyone stands up and says, I'm Spartacus.
In the same vein as The Elephant Man and John Merrick and those that, you know, we don't understand, but at the same time they have actually a bigger heart and a bigger emotion that we sometimes are capable of, how we can turn them into individuals that are capable of rising up and saying no.
Rick sprinkled throughout the movie allusions to not only the original but all the different movies, so there'd be kind of a Easter egg hunt for the fans.
It didn't so much start off that way. We were just looking for names of characters and ways to look for inspiration and start writing the script. But then it started to grow and we thought, oh, this would be cool if we wove this in, if we could weave that in. There is a reference to the Icarus. It's a nod to the past, but also, if it works, hoping that we can weave that back into one of the future movies if we get that lucky.
It's a very interesting thing because it's not necessarily obvious to do that, but when I read the script, I thought that's fantastic, because just to see something on the nightly news that is going on in our own world and the way we deal with space exploration, it is considered in the next 20 to 25 years that we will potentially have man on Mars. And that is exactly what Charlton Heston's mission was all about. So it's great to set that up.
The most obvious ones are some of the names. Maurice, I would think, would be extremely obvious. The orangutan, the connection to that. If you look deep into cast and crew, you'll find other names. I mean, way deep. Rocket. Buck. There are scientific numbers in the formulas that are directly linked to the previous movies. 112 is the therapy that's developed, and 112 minutes is the running time of the original. The therapy was called at one point RT-112, which I thought, you know, running time 112, but it ended up being changed in the development of the script. You know, it's a fine line between having a lot of fun. You don't want to go so far that it's ridiculous, you know.
It's very exciting when all of a sudden things are elevated. It's visually much more arresting and fascinating than anything we ever had on the page. Moments are brought to fruition in ways that are very exciting.
Amanda and I took great care in trying to please and win back a lot of the Planet of the Apes fans, at the same time realizing we were going to have to make some different changes. You know, you can't really do the same thing, especially if you're setting it in a contemporary way and you're trying to tell it in a very realistic way. It's been a great adventure for us as a team to create these characters and to develop Caesar into this character that hopefully everybody will embrace.
Hey, Dad. Want to see something?
What?
The journey of Caesar is in many ways the journey that the movie takes. And to have Andy Serkis play Caesar has been above and beyond my wildest hopes and expectations.
He's really brought a depth to the character. And once he's in it, he's just this very well-rounded and deep character who goes through this incredible transformation.
You know, and Andy is such an incredible actor. He gave really fantastic performances. You really feel this character go through a whole series of discoveries and setbacks and revelations, and he tells that story all in his face and in his body.
And it's just so great that in the world of performance capture, Andy Serkis is top of his field.
So what's your secret?
Oh, I can't take any credit. It's in his genes.
I think you're being very modest. He's pretty amazing.
Andy Serkis has created this new kind of performance in a way, and he fell into it. I mean, he was cast as Gollum just for his voice, and then I guess Peter Jackson realized what a great physical performance he was giving and that he should try and capture that in some way. So Andy kind of fell into this performance captured world and has really pioneered it, and so Rupert wanted him immediately.
That was great, the reaction.
He's one of those actors that's embraced the technology because he understands the potential of what it can achieve. And he's one of those actors that really understands that every nuance that he gives is conveyed onto the screen.
What makes Andy a really great performer in this kind of role, starting with Gollum and Lord of the Rings to the King Kong, and especially in the role of Caesar, is that he brings a lot of experience to it that's really relevant.
The basic usage of performance capture is to create a fidelity to the actor's performance. So when you see it on the screen, you will see the apes, but they're apes which are infused with the heart and soul of an actor's performance.
And Andy complements that in the work that he's done with us because he understands the animation process that goes through afterwards, so he knows what we're going to be able to add on to it afterwards so that everyone actually understands the nuances and the subtlety of the performance.
It's one of the technical and creative merges that we have in the movie. So technologically, we need to be able to capture Andy in his performance.
Take your stinking paw off me, you damn dirty ape!
No!
But there are times where Andy's presence is bigger than Caesar, so we use Devon for blocking and for being able to see a shape or a character that's more the actual size of Caesar.
Cut.
Working with Andy has been really awesome. I've learned so much working with him. He's amazing at it. And just kind of watching him mostly, I guess, or following him, and just really looking at everything he does to try and do it the exact same.
So the technique that we use is to first capture the scene with the performer who's going to be, in this case, Caesar, for example. We would perform the scene with Andy. And then afterwards, you'll do other things to try to fill in the missing gaps. Like you'll record the whole scene again without Andy so that we have information of what the camera might expect to see behind him, because he's bigger than Caesar. And so you have to paint in a lot of things to help take Andy out of the set. You might do it with a smaller performer or a stand-in just walking through the set just to get an actual size reference. There's things that you do to try to figure out what the lighting was doing, what the camera was doing on set. There's a lot of information that has to get gathered to kind of recreate in a virtual world everything that you see in the real world.
So it's a little bit like Roger Rabbit. I mean, you have the opportunity to have Andy playing Caesar acting alongside James, who's playing Will Rodman, the human scientist. And so we shoot that scene where the two of them are interacting. And of course, that's great. James doesn't have to act against thin air.
And so while we're acting, he is not in an ape suit. He's in, you know, these gray pajama looking things with sensors all over his body, and he has dots on his face that will help the effects team read his expressions in the computer. So you would think that acting opposite somebody like that and trying to think that they were a chimpanzee would be very difficult. But from the first scene that we had together on, you know, it's been easy, because Andy is so good at the behavior and he's so connected to what he's doing and, you know, the other actors, that he allows my imagination to take over, and I really can treat him as a very intelligent chimpanzee, but a chimpanzee. And that's basically, you know, what he's giving me there, this believable behavior, is basically what you look for from any other actor you're acting opposite. If they're good, they'll pull you into the scene and the circumstance. And so that's exactly what he's done.
But what you then have to do is you then have to take Andy out of the shot and you have to redo the scene again. And that's what's called a clean plate, where you're basically, you are doing Roger Rabbit, where James has to perform against nothing. And that's really challenging for everybody, because he's not reacting off of anything. He's having to basically create the energy of that scene.
So the time you feel silliest is when the shot is a close up on Andy, but he's not there. So basically the camera's just shooting a wall and I'm acting to that wall. But it's fine. I mean, you kind of just chalk it up to, you know, something that's necessary to make a movie like this.
I think the thing that makes Andy Serkis so good at performance capture is that he's a great actor. He has a great understanding of character, and he becomes so emotionally invested in those characters that it is sometimes, even though he's dressed in a funny suit and he's got markers and green dots on his face, you watch him, you know, on set and during the takes, and you're just completely there. You believe that he's a chimpanzee, even though nothing in his physical appearance would tell you otherwise. So, yeah, he's a top-notch actor.
And cut there. That's one bad motion.
I wasn't exactly sure whether they were going to be using real monkeys. I mean, obviously, I knew that Caesar was going to be something a little special, but when I heard that Andy Serkis was doing it, I was extraordinarily excited. Not only am I a huge fan, but I knew that he's going to make it a lot easier for me. The fact that I could react against someone, and it's terrifying seeing a human act that primitive, really, so that massively helps.
He really has nailed this kind of work, and it's the future in a way.
He's the one that brings these scenes to life, and he's a wonderful actor.
Performance capture is about getting inside the soul of whatever character you're playing, whether it's human or whether it's a creature or whether it's an ape. And I think that's the real thing that people haven't understood about performance capture. And they think performance capture is about servicing a visual effect. And it's none of those things. The emotional center of the performance will only come from an actor. And with Caesar, it's actually a brilliant tool.
It encapsulated within this extraordinary person is this talent that raises everybody else up. And it was amazing to see, and it included me. When you get onto a set with somebody like Andy Serkis, he has a spirit and an effervescence about him that, you know, all of the other apes, he became the leader of those apes. And it wasn't through dictating or in any way dominating any of the others. It was all about basically leading by example. And a lot of our actors that were playing the apes were from theater or from a stunt background. And in a way, the story mirrored the actual making of the movie, because he actually allowed them to believe in the fact that this was possible, that we could do this. And I think, you know, that's a really rare breed, that you get an actor that is that engaging and that encouraging and also brilliant.
Caesar's home.
Rise of the Planet of the Apes is the first live-action film that has its main character as a thoughtful, self-aware, feeling animal.
Caesar is truly a new paradigm in filmmaking, and it's a new paradigm because of the extent of the technical challenges of making this movie and it merging with the creative.
We are breaking very new ground here. I think Weta have done something that's quite extraordinary. Our story deals with real apes. We knew that we had to put to one side the idea of using prosthetics and human actors in animal suits. We couldn't do that.
At one point, we looked into using real apes, and for a variety of reasons, we just didn't do it.
Of course, it would be an irony to tell the story of the exploited and the mistreated and use live apes to do that. I don't think that's where we wanted to go. So we had the choice of exploring what we could do with performance capture to actually try and create photorealistic apes.
It really became about the performance. And that's where we really draw on you know, working with performers like Andy Serkis or like Terry Notary.
Trying to show this emotional journey of Caesar and show it through the emotion of how intelligent he is actually a very subtle kind of thing, and it would be pretty much impossible to do if we didn't have Andy Serkis basically acting out that journey for us, and then we're able to replicate it.
We had a movement expert who's probably the most experienced in terms of ape performance. His name is Terry Notary. He comes from a stunt background. I think he actually originated in Cirque du Soleil. He put everybody through ape school.
We're gonna just run you through a little bit of some of the exercises that we do. Really start in our first position, just like anything, like any technique, ballet, gymnastics, you have your basics. And our basics are this solid foundation of the first position. Then we go to take our first step, reach and absorb through the shoulder. Boom, keeping those hips square.
About 90% of it is getting in the mode of an ape and getting into the presence and the feel of what they, how they exist. And once you get that, the movement comes much more naturally, and it's much more organic that way.
There's a couple of details that you have to think about when you're creating something like this, when you're going for photorealism. The quality of the skin, the quality of the eyes, the quality of the fur.
The lips, the moisture in the skin, the shine, that we want to make the apes look as realistic as possible.
It all starts off with a lot of research and development in the beginning.
We were able to work with our friends at the Wellington Zoo and look at the chimps there and to really study them. There's a lot of information that has to get gathered to kind of recreate in a virtual world everything that you see in the real world.
To go into some of the anatomical detail, we also reference real apes as well, just to look at how the muscles move and bone structure and facial structure.
Learning about the skeletons, learning about the way the muscles are laid out in the character.
We build all the anatomy for the creature, its skeleton, its muscles, the skin.
Even nerve bundles and stuff like that, because what we really try to do is fill the entire inside of the creature with the stuff that actually drives it.
The creatures really do have the correct anatomical layers. We'll basically start to build all these different layers of the underlying anatomy. So we'll build a skull, okay? So you'll never see a skull apart from his teeth, obviously, but his jawbone and his skull will get built and fitted to the model. And then we'll go and build all the underlying sort of musculature of the model. So, you know, his neck muscles and all the different skeletal muscles get modeled. You never directly see that in the finished result, but you see the effect of all these different things solving out.
And then from there, then it would come to our department, where the textures department, where we had to actually put in all the very fine wrinkles, all the pores, and the coloration on all the characters. And we were also able to get hand and feet casts of these guys, and again, that was just a huge bonus for us in the textures department, because we can transfer those realistic textures into our digital models, which in turn just makes them look that much more realistic.
Having a silicone scan of a real chimp or a real ape's hand or face, I mean, that allows for a one-to-one placement of the same detail that you would get in real life. To have this type of detail really makes life much easier. And as you can see, we can, you know, toggle around the character and zoom in to and focus on any particular area that we need to detail. These are all great tools that just, you know, a couple years ago didn't exist. And as you can see, now I can rotate and I can see all the detail that I've just put into the model. Roughly around the same time, the model department are doing the groom, laying out the fur.
Caesar was broken down into multiple fur sets, which were defined by different characteristics of types of hair that would grow naturally on a, you know, ape or human. We've got the mane fur groom. We also have the peach fuzz and facial hair. So I'm just gonna paint out areas I don't want hair to grow on. The areas that are black will not be growing any hair, will be completely bald. So I turn all these on and you've got the complete kind of color-coded groom of Caesar. The tools we used on apes were really quite unique in the sense that before we had a limited kind of amount of control. We're now with Barbershop, like what we have in screen is actually like physical geometry, like it exists in this environment. I can go in and actually tweak a single hair, essentially. Now this could be a good point to use the actual combing tool to kind of block in a bit of the silhouette. We can actually see that the hair is being affected by the light source. I can see really close to what we're going to see in a final render.
And everything kind of gets put together and it all kind of goes back again to the actual motion capture that Andy and the team did of getting all the movements of the apes and the very subtle facial expressions.
Probably the main thing for us is in terms of getting that emotional performance would be the eyes.
We went to a local eye doctor and sat down and asked him tons of questions, you know, in the research, like how do they move and what caused you to blink and how does a blink, how do the muscles actually pull when they blink? We even went into research on how the liquid of the eye sits at the bottom of your eyelid and what keeps it from rolling out and what kind of surface does it build so that when we're lighting the eyes, you get that little glint of highlight that happens from the way that the tear film fills up in the bottom of the eye.
All the eye movement and the face and the little thoughts and the feelings that go behind the emotions all read so well and they just get translated right into the ape.
You've got entire scenes that are playing here where the performers are working off each other and there's no dialogue, but you still have to understand what's transpiring between them and you start to see that going on behind his eyes. That's all Andy and we just wanted to make sure we brought that to the screen.
You see within the eye swivel all of the soul and the sense of thought, and it was a thinking chimpanzee, and I think that's really unsettling.
The most challenging scenes are the scenes where Caesar is a toddler, because it's where we had the most size discrepancy between Andy and Caesar. See, when you're doing animation, it's all about the weight, so you're never trying to go lighter. You're always trying to make sure you have the appropriate weight. But in this case, we had to take the movements and just say, okay, Andy's doing this, but he's an adult male, so when he does that, what does that mean for a toddler chimp?
For us, at least in animation, the key scene that we really felt we needed to get through was the scene where Will leaves him at the ranch.
There's a point where he realizes after Will's gone back inside the office, he realizes that he's to be left behind. The rising panic and then the various emotions that he went through in that reasonably short scene.
It was huge facial challenges. Andy contorted his face in all these different ways, and we knew we had to get that scene, and if we couldn't get that scene, none of the following scenes would matter that much.
A lot of development of the face rig was actually done based around that particular scene. Some of the extremes that Andy's, the muscles in Andy's face reached, you know, multiple combinations of muscles. And then on top of that, of course, the performance called for him to be pressing his face up against glass.
We actually had modeled the pane of glass in 3D and we had the animator's performance, and then we just kind of squashed his face against the glass and it kind of did the right thing, like the skin kind of deformed and sort of dragged along this glass surface as you'd expect. So that kind of stuff, being able to do that, is pretty new.
I'm coming back soon, okay?
The first time that I saw the fully rendered Caesar up on screen, I was completely blown away. I mean, there was my performance, all the emotion, all the eye movements, the gestures, all cloaked in this digital chimpanzee skin, and it was quite something.
On the set of the Golden Gate Bridge. This is where the final battle sequence takes place. This is the largest mocap volume in the world and the first time it's been done outside. So Weta is basically changing all the rules with motion capture.
It was a world first. We had to create the Golden Gate Bridge as a live, physically built set, but we then had to have performance-captured apes on that bridge, and we therefore had to use all of the technology that Weta brought to a real location.
The timing for us is lucky. We came right at a time when Jim Cameron and Weta had done something that had never been done before. Joe Letteri and his group down there had perfected this performance capture. You know, we were shooting exteriors and performance capture. No movie's ever done that.
Action!
Well, what we did is we created these cameras that were able to see all the performance capture markers and information in daylight. It was kind of setting those up and hiding them so that when you're photographing the set, you don't see the cameras, but they're there and they're recording what the actors are doing. And then you have an actor who is in his full mocap suit and he's in there acting with everyone that is in on the performance with him.
It's a one big Velcro piece suit. They've upgraded to these infrared sensors the cameras can pick up outside in daylight. This is breaking new ground. It's really nice to be outside on the Golden Gate Bridge with real live action actors and cars as apes. That was awesome.
There were a whole lot of other things that we had to take into account, you know, the heat and the moisture. And so we built little closures over the motion capture camera so they wouldn't get fried if it started to drizzle a little bit.
Unfortunately, because we were doing the motion capture in the photography that we were doing, you couldn't just put cameras wherever you wanted to. So we ended up having a fixed row of cameras along the green screen wall, but there were also cameras that were on movable towers that we could kind of position in and out.
We came up with this quick recalibration process where we had the object of known dimensions and they would be put into the space to quickly recalibrate the cameras because we had to move them so much.
So I'm about to calibrate the motion capture system with this device here we call the wand. It's a known device. All the cameras are about to watch me wave it around. Looks a little silly, but let's just do what we do here. This is our other calibration device. It's we call it the L-frame. It looks like the coordinate system and a graph. So we place it out here so the cameras can see it. And then between the wand and the L-frame, we can figure out where we are.
The Golden Gate Bridge set was huge. I mean, it's six lanes of traffic with sidewalks on either side. And so the challenge of trying to actually see what was being recorded there was pretty extreme because we had to be high and far away in order to be able to mount the cameras to cover the whole set. But you got actors with little dots glued to their costumes that are far away, and each of these cameras has to be able to track all the dots that are going on amongst all the cars and the reflections and figure out what's going on to discern the movement of all these apes running around.
With the second unit stuff, they know what they're going to shoot, but a lot of the choreography happens 10 minutes before we're going to shoot it. So they'll choreograph a bit where all of the apes are coming over the railing and attacking the police officers. And then the next sequence where we're all parading over the cars, that's all real.
The boom.
And yeah. It starts to lift up, and then, yeah, maybe yeah. Somebody grabs
and
it,
then,
whatever.
And then it's like, boom, boom, we all walk our hands.
Really help you get you in character. Just like pop them in, you're there.
So the technique that we use is to first capture the scene with the performer, and then afterwards you'll do other things to try to fill in the missing gaps. Like you'll record the whole scene again so that we have information of what the camera might expect to see behind him. And so you have to paint in a lot of things to help take the performer out of the set. There's a lot of information that has to get gathered to recreate in a virtual world everything that you see in the real world.
So much of what you're having to replace is very reflective because it's all about just a bunch of shiny cars. So you take an ape performer who's running down a row of cars and you're not only having to paint out them, but you're also having to deal with their reflection that's in the car they're standing on, the car in front of them, the car behind them. If the camera moves from here to here, the reflection changes quite a bit. The trickiest part about the whole thing was just trying to make sure we actually had coverage. We had up to 80 cars basically lined up in rows. There were lots of occlusion issues. You'd have ape performers that would be dipping in between and in amongst these vehicles.
Action!
We
One of the biggest challenges from a practical point of view for an animator is the sheer number of apes that we have in some of these shots.
When you're talking about apes within that particular sequence, you're having to shoot 6 or 7 performance capture artists, because that's really the maximum that you can capture at any one time. And they have to represent 150 apes. You then have to block everything accordingly. You have to block all the extras in exactly the same way over and over again.
Background action and action.
When they shot it on the set, there was 3 or 4 actors that they had that they were actually motion capturing. So we had those guys to start with, but then we would have to go back to our motion capture library where we have all these random run cycles and jumps and climbing over cars and start adding all those in as well. So a shot that originally had 3 ape performers in it ends up having 150 apes in it.
It's getting the scale of the bridge. I mean, we could only build a section of the bridge, and then our plan was then we would extend the set digitally.
We actually created, you know, a full digital set of the Golden Gate Bridge, and we created the surrounding hills and the ocean. It's quite a massive set that we actually ended up building. When we first started, we started looking at the sequences that were being turned over, and we looked at the previs that was being done, and we started to try to break down like where those actions were happening across the Golden Gate Bridge.
Starts out with seeing the live plate shots of the bridge and getting a lot of photo reference of the actual bridge as well as the one that was on set. And from that, then it goes to the models department, and the models has to figure out how to match everything exactly. Once all that stuff passes through the models department, it comes to us, then we start all the procedural texturing.
And then that is passed off to the lighting department to do the final rendering.
There are lots of digital car extensions. In addition to just the cars that we see going off into the fog, there's also interaction with those vehicles. During the shoot, the special effects teams had rigged up some of the vehicles for those clean passes that we shot with hydraulic rigs and things that would actually shake the vehicles as if there were apes, you know, running over them. We're doing digital hood and car roof replacements so that we can actually get dents and dings and take weight under the apes.
It was amazing. It was probably the hardest thing I've ever done in my life physically. The beautiful thing about it was that we got to use and interact with real props. And we were jumping over real cars. We were smashing real windows. It was something that you didn't have to pretend.
We used our ape performance. We used real stunts, hundreds of cars. We used hundreds of extras. And there's an extraordinary atmosphere, but it uses every part of the bridge. It's quite an event.
So that was one of the main breakthroughs of the film, was being able to really complete the two performance capture worlds coming together. What we're hoping people take away from what Weta brought to the film is just believing what you see. We really just enjoy making films where you can sit there and look at it and say, wow, I didn't know this existed, but it must.
From the top, everyone, tutti, I think it's the whole band, 16 clicks in. Christ, time to count for me, will you?
I was approached by the producers of the picture and the director, Rupert Wyatt, to talk about the score. The aims of the narrative were to tell the story of the central character, Caesar, and the music should tell a story that wasn't said in dialogue terms. There was so little dialogue in the first half of the film because we only have images of it rather than dialogue. So that was his main concern, they should do that, and that never changed. The relationship between Will and Caesar and Will's father, as he prized himself away from that family, it would be a difficult journey for the music and the movie itself to bring him into this world of the primates and to separate himself. So the whole process, I knew, wasn't going to be easy because the film itself is taking on like life itself. So it's a big, big topic. It sort of pulled a lot of the music back in certain places and made it do less. It's an evolving process.
Nice.
Yep. We had a big symphonic orchestra, and it's such a fantastic room, the Newman Stage, and I've never scored it before, so that was very exciting. I've never seen so much space. The musicians spread all over that in a massive and all the, in Europe were crushed altogether. So that was exciting to be on that great stage. I use the horns a lot to give some grit. They provided some great excitement. These sort of sequences, these chromatic sequences going up and down, that gave you such power. All the sounds of the orchestra were down low and dirty and deep, you know, lots of rhythms that sort of doubled the percussion. So that was the sense, this driving force, keep the audience attentive on the edge of their seat. And let the wonderful images and let the amazing sound effects I'm making to let these people in do their job. Like, for example, to have all the brasses and strings swelling to, and out of it comes the roar of the gorilla. So I start it, and then he joins my chord, and I let him finish off his roar. That's a wonderful passing the baton to the different departments, and that's what makes it for the audience, this timing, this wonderful sense of movie timing, it comes from all departments. In fact, one of the themes came from one of the ape noises Chuck gave me. So I thought, I went with the music, and that became, I went through the whole movie, that first piece of ape noise was inspirational to me. It stuck right through the movie.
Actually, Jim, let's put horn three on it as well, please. Here we go.
And then the escape's just an incredible sequence where suddenly the entire city of San Francisco is literally swarms of apes. It was the way they kind of crawled over the cars and everything else that reminded me of kind of like bees. And I wanted the music to do like a low buzzing swarm, you know, but these are ugly, so it was like enormous, big, ugly swarm of apes, low and dirty. And then all the high sounds of the apes and the effects can ride above it, so we're both working in tandem.
Okay, so let's change the bell to ha. Ha.
The African voices, we experimented with them. Used them a lot for drones, a lot for rhythm during the action sequence.
That's it? Yeah.
It was a process of experimentation, which I knew would be.
There's a scene here where the ape is giving cookies to all the other apes and getting them fired up. And our composer was singing to himself, as this tale goes, a few nights ago, this silly thing, and he said, I got a cookie for you. I got a cookie for you. I got a cookie for you, right? The silliest thing you could ever think. It's a big, massive scene. It's all tense. And what's he saying? I got a cookie. Then suddenly, he starts to write. Right, the whole thing develops, and suddenly we have this massive action cue.
Took this very difficult scene, and I felt the surge of, I know what this is. I've got a cookie for you. I thought, that's ridiculous. I've got a cookie for you. I thought it made me laugh. It was a serious scene. And we started to build up. I've got a cookie for you. I thought, I dare sing to these people that come around to hear it. I've got a cookie for you. But I couldn't resist it.
When he told me how he got that rhythm going and how that whole silly thing from, I got a cookie for you. I said, we gotta have these guys record voices in. I
do this a lot in movies. I sort of put lyrics to things. I got a cookie for you. And again.
hilarious. Look, if you can't have a bit of fun, you'll go insane. It's been the most serious movie in many ways, one of the most difficult scores I've ever done. It's a wonderful moment of light relief, which is, I think, we all relished. You're just like the cookie. I've had a ball, and everyone's been very kind to me. I've got a great team involved. We've all had a fantastic time and been very well looked after.